Hello everyone. So in today's video, we are going to go over this paper from 2018 titled Toward Controlled Generation of Text. And the authors are Ziting Hu, Zixiao Yang, Ziaodan Liang, Ruslan Ruslan Salakhutdinov, and Eric Pijing. I'm really sorry if I mispronounce any of those names. So this paper is a paper which I haven't read before, so this would be my first time reading it with you guys. Alright, so let's just start with the abstract. Generic generation and manipulation of text is challenging and has limited success compared to recent deep generative modeling in visual domain. So the paper aims at generating plausible text sentences whose attributes are controlled by learning disentangled latent representations with designated semantics. We propose a new neural generative model which combines variational autoencoders and holistic attribute discriminators for effective imposition of semantic structures. The model can alternatively be seen as enhancing variational autoencoders with the wake sleep algorithm for leveraging fake samples as extra training data, with differentiable approximation to discrete text samples, explicit constraints on independent attribute controls, and efficient collaborative learning of generator and discriminator. Our model learns interpretable representations from even only word annotations and produces sentences with desired attributes of sentiment and tenses. Qualitative experiments using trained classifiers as evaluators validate the accuracy of short sentences and attribute generation. So the abstract was quite heavy, to be honest. So let's just get into the paper, and maybe section by section we'll understand it better. Alright, so the introduction. There is a surge of research interest in deep generative models such as variational autoencoders. True. Generative adversarial net GANs and autoregressive models, despite their impressive advances in visual domains such as image generation, learning interpretable image representations, and image editing, application to natural language generation have been relatively less studied. So personally, how I read these papers is I try to understand each and every sentence, and if suppose some sentence does not make sense, I try to link it to say a few sentences which come after it. Maybe they have some additional context about it. So far I believe these two sentences are pretty self-explanatory. Variational autoencoders, GANs, and autoregressive models are extensively used in the visual domain. So remember, this paper is from 2018. Now these are also being used extensively in the NLP domain. So even generating realistic sentences is challenging, as the generative models are required to capture complex semantic structure underlying sentences. Previous work have been mostly limited to task-specific applications in supervised settings, including machine translation and image captioning. However, autoencoder frameworks and recurrent neural network models do not apply to generic text generation from arbitrary hidden representations due to the unsmoothness of effective hidden codes. Very few attempts of using VAEs and GANs have been made to investigate generic text generation, while the generated text is largely randomized and uncontrollable. Alright, so basically they're saying that these things, previous work using these things such as encoders and GANs, etc., have been limited in machine translation and image captioning. So machine translation is basically say English to German and so on, and image captioning is basically you show image to the system and the system generates a caption for the image. But then they say that the autoencoder framework and RNN language models do not apply to generic text generation from arbitrary hidden representations. So basically, they say that the hidden codes are not so smooth that you can just give them to the model and the model generates text. So in the very few works at this time, when the paper was published, the texts were largely randomized and uncontrollable. So in this paper we tackle the problem of control generation. So this problem, that is, we focus on generating realistic sentences whose attributes can be controlled by learning disentangled latent representations. So if you've seen my previous video on style transfer, then basically each sentence S has two properties in a style transfer setting. It has a content and it has a style. So a style ST and a content CO. The content remains invariant when you do style transfers. Suppose you go from one style to the other, suppose from a humorous to a sad style, the content should remain the same while the style changes. This is style transfer. And this part of separating the style and the content in a style transfer setting is this latent disentangling. So latent space disentangling. So basically, you create a model, an encoder, which takes this sentence, passes it through an encoder network, and generates a vector. So I'm sorry about the bad shape, badly shaped vector. I'll try to redraw it. Right. So this is a vector, and this is the latent space representation. And then this vector passes through a decoder. And in other complex settings, you have other works such as style transformer, etc., to get back the sentence. So this effectively is your latent space representation of the sentence, and then you do style transfer, so you'll get some other style sentence here and so on. Sorry. Right. So in this paper, we tackle right to enable the manipulation of generated sentences. A few challenges need to be addressed. All right. So a first challenge comes from the discrete nature of text samples. The resulting non-differentiability hinders the use of global discriminators that assess generated samples and backpropagate gradients to guide optimization of generators in a holistic manner, as shown to be highly effective in continuous image generation and representation modeling. All right. So let's just break this part down. The resulting non-differentiability. Why is it non-differentiable? Because it is not being generated from some fixed continuous function. Text tokens are discrete. You have, suppose, a sentence, I am a. Then there is no fixed word which can come after it. Someone might write boy, someone might write girl, someone might write I am a driver, or I am an astronaut, or I am a scientist, and so on and so forth. So this is discontinuous. You do not have any notion of differentiability. Like, how would you even define differentiability in such tokens? So global discriminators that assess generated samples and backpropagate gradients to guide optimization are shown to be highly effective in continuous image generation. So you can think that they have continuity here, and in also differentiability. So you can propagate back the gradients. So a number of recent approaches attempt to address the non-differentiability through policy learning, which tends to suffer from high variance during training or continuous approximations, where only preliminary qualitative results are presented. All right. So another approach is using policy learning. So I'm not sure what policy learning is. I think if they describe it in the paper, then we'll get to learn about it. But high variance is basically a statistical, it's something which pops up in statistics if you've done statistics. So suppose, let's see if we have some good graphic. Right. So basically, when the model overfits to the data, then you can see that the model is essentially memorizing the data points, right? It is not really learning anything. Then you get high variance because you can see there is no smoothness. It's like arbitrary jumps just to fit in the points. So that is not good, right? Because you do not want the model to overfit. So this is essentially trying to say, I believe that these models overfit, or they have continuous approximations. So they use some sort of approximations which might lead to loss of data during training. So you approximate the values in some fashion, then you lose out some additional data. So as an alternative to the discriminator-based learning, semi-supervised variational autoencoders, or VAEs, minimize element-wise reconstruction error on observed examples and are applicable to discrete variables. This, however, loses a holistic view of full sentences and can be inferior, especially for modeling global abstract attributes, example sentiment. All right. So let's see if we can get some visual for variational autoencoders. So a variational autoencoder basically has an input. It stacks a lot of encoders. It gets a latent space representation, and then it you can see the encoders keep decreasing in size. So you can see that the encoder size is decreased. So the latent space representation acts as a bottleneck. So you can imagine something like this. Your input is first going into some sort of tunnel like this. Then you have your latent space representation, and then it grows back. So you have a vector input here, and you have a vector output here. And then to learn the latent space representation, they try to generate the same sentence. So they try to minimize the distance between x and x dash. So in this context, they are images, but in other contexts, they can be text-based also. All right. So semi-supervised is basically not totally supervised and not fully unsupervised. They minimize element-wise reconstruction error on observed samples and are applicable to discrete visibles. All right. So firstly, what is element-wise reconstruction error? So basically this part, I believe. So there is an error associated with getting the word am. You might have predicted some wrong word, or you might have predicted some wrong word here, or you might predict some wrong word here. So this is element wise error and are applicable to discrete visibles. So I'm not really sure what discrete visibles are. Let me just look up discrete visibles. Probably they describe it somewhere later, because I cannot find anything relevant right now. This, however, loses the holistic view of full sentences, because now you are trying to create tokens, one token at a time, and not looking at the global scale, I guess, and can be inferior, especially for modeling global abstract attributes. So if you are trying to control, say, the sentiment in the sentence, you cannot do it in this fashion. All right. Another challenge for controllable generation relates to learning disentangled latent representations. So interpretability expects each part of the latent representation to govern and only focus on one aspect of the sample. Prior methods on structured representation learning lack explicit enforcement of the independence property on the full latent representation, and varying individual code may result in unexpected variation of other unspecified attributes beside the desired one. Alright, so basically what they're saying is they want each part of the latent representation to govern and only focus on one of the aspects. So one should focus on feature one, one should focus on feature two, but that is not how it really happens, because when in practice they've observed that this is very difficult to obtain. So in this paper, we propose a new text generative model that addresses the above issues, permitting highly disentangled representations with designated semantic structure and generating sentences with dynamically specified attributes. We base our generator on variational autoencoders in combination with holistic discriminators of attributes for effective imposition of structure on the latent code. So these two are their building blocks, autoencoders and holistic discriminators. End-to-end optimization is enabled with differentiable softmax approximation, which anneals smoothly to discrete case and helps fast conversions. So basically, softmax approximation is you apply a softmax on a function, and then you get a probability distribution over all the tokens. The probabilistic encoder of VAE also functions as an additional discriminator to capture variations of implicitly modeled aspects and guide the generator to avoid entanglement during attribute code manipulation. Alright, so this part is something, I guess, which they'll explain in their work, because I'm not really sure what they're trying to say here. So to capture variations of implicitly modeled aspects, like, you can get some idea of what they're trying to say. The VAE also has a probabilistic encoder. So they are saying that it also acts as a discriminator. It captures variations in the aspect, different things which are implicitly modeled by the model. So I guess a better explanation would be somewhere later. Our model can be interpreted by enhancing VAEs with an extended wake-sleep procedure, where the sleep phase enables incorporation of generated samples for learning both generator and discriminator in an alternating manner. So the generator and the discriminator effectively provide feedback signal to each other, resulting in an efficient mutual bootstrapping framework. We show a little supervision is sufficient to learn structured representations. Alright. So in the wake-sleep procedure, you have some generated sentences, and they are used to train the generator and discriminator in an alternating manner. So once the generator, then the discriminator, and so on. The generator and the discriminator effectively provide feedback signal to each other. So if the generator becomes strong, it produces better texts, then the discriminator starts falling behind, then the discriminator learns, then the generator might easily catch the generator's text, and then the generator has to learn again, and so on. So besides efficient representation learning and enabled semi-supervised training, another advantage of using discriminator as learning signals for the generator as compared to conventional conditional reconstruction based methods. Besides efficient representation learning and enabled semi-supervised training, another advantage of using discriminators as learning signals for a generator as compared to conventional conditional reconstruction based methods is that discriminators of different attributes can be trained independently. So you can have a discriminator which classifies on the basis of sentiment, one which classifies on the basis of some other feature, and so on. That is, for each attribute one can use a separately labeled data for training the respective discriminator, and a trained discriminator can be combined arbitrarily to control a set of attributes of interest. So in contrast, reconstruction based approaches typically require every instance of the training data to be labeled exhaustively with all target attributes, or to marginalize out any missing attributes which can be computationally expensive. Alright. So basically what they're saying is, if they use different discriminators, then suppose they want to control the style, or they want to control the sentiment, then they can do that by using a discriminator which is trained on different styles or is trained on different sentiments. They do not need to train a model and have annotations for each and every parameter. They only need the annotations for the parameters which they want to control. So as a showing case, we apply a model to generate sentences with controlled sentiment and tenses. Though to our best knowledge, there is no text corpus with both sentiment and tense labels, our method enables to use separate data sets, one with annotated sentiment and other with tense labels. So they'll, I guess, use two different discriminators for each of these. Quantitative experiments demonstrate the efficacy of our method. Our model improves our previous generative models on the accuracy of generating specified attributes, as well as performing classification using generated samples. We show our method learns highly disentangled representation from only word-level labels and produces plausible short sentences. So really looking forward to the examples which they have. So the related works. Remarkable progress has been made in deep generative modeling, who at all provide a unified view of a diverse set of deep generative methods. Variational autoencoders consist of encoder and generator networks which encode a data example to a latent representation and generate sample from the latent representation respectively. So we were having a look at this this part. So you get a latent space representation and then you generate something back using a decoder. The model is trained The model is trained by maximizing a variational lower bound on the data log likelihood under the generative model. So this is basically the training method which they're using. A KL divergence loss is minimized to match the posterior of the latent code with the prior, which enables every latent code from the prior to decode into a plausible sentence. So the KL divergence loss is just a loss function, a fancy loss function. and this is the formula for the KL divergence law. So you can see I do not have an intuitive explanation right now for it, but I guess you would find one. Let's just try to look up intuition. Maybe we find something. The intuition for the KL divergence score is that when the probability for an event from P is large but the probability for the same event in Q is small, there is a large divergence. Okay, so over two different distributions. Okay, so maybe they are somehow trying using different distributions to see if the same token has a high probability of occurring from one and a low from another, then that means there is high divergence and the loss function then fixes sent signals back for the model to adjust itself. So without the KL regularization, variational autoencoders degenerate to autoencoders and become inapplicable for the generic generation. The vanilla VAEs are incompatible with discrete latents as they hinder differentiable parameterization for learning the encoder. The wake-sleep algorithm introduced for learning deep directed graphical models shares similarity with variational autoencoders by also combining an inference network with the generator. The wake phase updates the generators with samples generated from the inference network on training data, while the sleep phase updates the inference network based on samples from the generator. So you have a inference network, you have a generator, the generator learns, then its learning helps the network, inference network, and when the inference network learns, then it is able to catch the generator, then the generator adjusts itself. So it's sort of a game. Alright. The wake phase updates our method combines variational autoencoders with an extended wake sleep in which the sleep procedure updates both the generator and discriminator, enabling collaborative semi-supervised learning. Alright, so I guess this was clear. Besides reconstruction in raw data space, discriminator-based metric provide a different way for generator learning. That is, the discriminator assesses generated samples and feedback learning signals. Alright, so for instance, GANs use a discriminator to feedback the probability of a sample being recognized as a real example. So GANs use a discriminator to feedback the probability of a sample. Right, so the generator generates a sentence and the discriminator predicts whether it is real or not. Larson et al. Combined VAEs with GANs for enhanced image generation. Dosovitsky and Brox and Teigman et al. Use discriminators to measure high level perceptual similarity. Applying discriminators to text generation is hard due to non-differentiability. So instead use VAEs without discriminators in these works. All these text generation methods do not learn disentangled latent representation, learning in randomized and uncontrollable samples. In contrast, disentangled generation in visual domain has made impressive progress. For example, InfoGAN, which resembles the extended sleep procedure of a joint VAE wake sleep algorithm, disentangles latent representation in an unsupervised manner. The semantic of each dimension is observed after training rather than designated by users in a controllable way. Okay. In these works, they base on VAEs and obtain disentangled image representation with semi-supervised learning. In this work, they extend semi-supervised variational autoencoders for text transduction. In contrast, our model combines VAEs with discriminators, which provide a better holistic metric compared to element-wise reconstruction. Moreover, most of these approaches have only focused on the disentanglement of the structure on latent representations while ignoring potential dependence of the structured code with attributes not explicitly encoded. We address this by introducing an independency constraint and show its effectiveness for improved interpretability. Alright. So towards here, they mention all these works which they have used different techniques, and in the end they tell what they've chosen and what they're going with. Alright. So controlled generation of text. Our model aims to generate plausible sentences conditioned on representation vectors which are endowed with designated semantic structures. For instance, to control sentence sentiment, our model allocates one dimension of the latent representation to encode positive and negative semantics and generates samples with desired sentiment by applying specifying simply specifying a particular code. Benefiting from the disentangled structure, each such code is able to capture a salient attribute and is independent with other features. Our deep text generative model possesses several merits compared to prior work. It facilitates effective imposition of latent code semantics by enabling global discriminators to guide the discrete text generation learning. So this might seem all high and fancy, but simply put, the global discriminator is trying to catch the generated text, whether is it real or fake, and then the model tries to improve based on that. And improve the model interpretability by explicitly enforcing the constraints on independent attribute control. So basically, now you have different discriminators. So one discriminator might catch something, another might catch something. So that is in one way where you are explicitly enforcing the constraints on independent attribute. So it's not up to just one system to check all the different attributes. Permits effective, efficient, semi-supervised learning and bootstrapping by synthesizing variational autoencoders with a tailored wake-sleep approach. We've seen the wake-sleep approach already. Alright. So the model overview. We build our framework starting from variational autoencoders, which have been used for text generation, where sentence X is generated conditioned on latent code Z. Latent code Z is nothing but this. And you generate X dash from it. The vanilla, which is here labeled as X hat, the vanilla VAE employs an unstructured vector Z in which the dimensions are entangled. To model and control the attributes in an interpretable way, we augment the unstructured variable Z with a set of structured variables C, each of which has a independent represents an independent semantic feature. So basically, you have a vector which is generated here, this part, this Z, and then you add on another vector to this. This vector has different attributes as each of its entry. So this attribute might represent the sentiment, this might represent the humor, this might have something else and so on. And this is with a set of structured variable C. So this is vector C, each of which targets a salient and independent semantic feature. Each of these are semantic features. Alright. So we want our sentence generated to condition on the combined vectors Z, C and generate samples that fulfill the attributes as specified in the structured code C while following the unstructured vector Z. Conditional generation in the context of VAEs is often learned by reconstructing observed samples from their feature code. However, as demonstrated in visual domain, compared to computing element-wise distances in the data space, computing distances in the feature space allows invariance to distracting transformations and provides a better holistic metric. So what this saying is, in the visual domain, instead of having element-wise distances in the data space, they compute distances in a feature space. So allows invariance to distracting transformations and provides a better holistic metric. So they are taking the entire vector instead of elements of the vector, I suppose. Alright. So thus, for each attribute code in C, we set up an individual discriminator to measure how well the generated samples match the desired attributes and drive the generator to produce improved results. The difficulty of applying discriminators in our context is that text samples are discrete and non-differentiable, which breaks down gradient propagation from the discriminator to the generator. We use a continuous approximation based on softmax with a decreasing temperature, which annealed to the discrete case as training proceeds. This simple yet effective approach enjoys low variance and fast convergence. So as you might remember, you need low variance for a good balance. Alright, so intuitively, having an interpretable representation would imply that each structured code in C can independently control its target feature without entangling with other attributes, especially those not explicitly modeled. We encourage the independency by enforcing those irrelevant attributes to be completely captured in the unstructured code and thus be separated from C that we will manipulate. To this end, we reuse the VAE encoder as an additional discriminator for recognizing the attributes modeled in Z and train the generator so that these unstructured attributes can be recovered from the generated samples. As a result, varying different attribute codes will keep the unstructured attributes invariant as long as Z is unchanged. So basically what they're saying is this bottleneck Z has the attributes which they do not want to manipulate. So, and that vector C has the attributes which they do want to manipulate. So now it is easy for them to manipulate the attributes which they want while not touching the attributes which they do not want to hinder. So figure 1 shows the overall model structure. Let's just read this. Our complete model incorporates VAEs and attribute discriminators, in which the VAE component trains the generator to reconstruct real sentences for generating plausible text, while the discriminator infers the generator to produce attributes coherent with the conditioned code. So the discriminator will say, oh, you are not producing the right style. Then the generator will have to learn how to produce the right style to try to fool the discriminator that this is a real sample. But then the discriminator will learn, and so on. That is, the generator and discriminator form a pair of collaborative learners and provide feedback signals to each other. The collaborative optimization resembles wake sleep algorithm, which they've talked. We showed the combined VAE wake sleep learning enables a highly efficient semi-supervised framework which requires only little supervision to obtain interpretable representation and generation. So let's have a look at the model. You have X, it goes to an encoder, you get a latent space representation Z. Then you add C, which is a structured code targeting sentence attribute. So you control this part, you do not control Z, ideally. Then this goes to a generator and you produce a sentence X bar, X hat. Then the discriminator tries to predict, is X hat real or fake? If it is, the discriminator is checking for attribute 3, then it will see if according to it this sentence has attribute 3 or not. If it does not, then it will change C. If it has, still based on the probability, it might tweak it a little so that it gives a higher probability, and so on. Also, it is used in the encoder again. This denotes the dependency constraint. So we'll have a look at this in section 3.2, which is the next section. And these red arrows denote the gradient. So the gradient goes back through the generator from these two things, from the encoder and the discriminator. All right. So now let's have a look at the model structure. We now describe our model in detail by presenting the learning of generator and discriminator respectively. The generator G is an LSTM RNN for generating token sentence condition on a latent code, which depicts a generative distribution. So it produces this sentence based on the input latent code and the attribute vector, where you tell, okay, it should have this attribute or not have this attribute. So this is the probability of getting the sentence X hat given a particular Z latent space vector Z and a style C and attribute C. So this is the probability over all the tokens multiplied. So you need to predict all the tokens. And this just denotes when you predict the TH token, then you will also use all the tokens before it during prediction. So the generation involves a sequence of discrete decision making, which samples a token from a multinomial distribution parameterized using softmax. So the softmax generates a probability distribution over all the tokens, and then the one with the highest probability is chosen, where this is a logit vector as input to the softmax, and this is a temperature normally set to 1. So this is how temperature controlling is done in softmax. Let's see if we can get some good infographic or right. So you can see with different temperatures, instead of just yi, you have yi by t. So you can see that this value will now be smaller, I guess. Yeah, it would be smaller. Let's just see if we have some good visual. Right. One reason to use a temperature function is to change the output distribution computed by your neural net. It is added to the log its vector according to this equation. Okay. You see, what this will do is change the final probability. So you can choose t to be anything. The higher the t, the softer the distribution. What I mean by softer is that the model will basically be less confident about its prediction as t gets closer to 0, the harder the distribution gets. Okay. So a harder distribution would mean that the model is more confident, and when it is softer, then the model is less confident. Okay. A is a harder distribution, your model is very confident. However, in many cases, you don't want your model to do that. For example, if you are using RNN to generate text, you are basically sampling from your output distribution and choosing the sampled word as your input. If your model is extremely confident, it may produce very repetitive and uninteresting text. Okay, you want it to produce more diverse text, which it will not produce, because when the sampling procedure is going on, most of the probability mass will be concentrated in a few tokens. Okay, so at that point, you need to use softmax. With regards to why high temperature leads to softer distribution, this has something to do with the exponential function. Exponential function is an increasing function, so if a term is really big, penalizing it with a small amount would make it much smaller than if it was a small term. Okay, so if you have 100, and so let's just have a look at an example. You have exponential 6 as 403 and exponential 3 as 20. So if you penalize it by 1.5, then you can see this goes from 403 all the way to 54. So this gets shrinked more as compared to this. And this is a pretty great question. Even though this does not fall into ML, because ML theory is not really something which Stack Overflow directly answers. There are other stack exchanges. Alright. Where were we? Right. So the temperature. The unstructured part Z is modeled as continuous variables with standard Gaussian prior, while the structured code C can contain both continuous and discrete values to encode different attributes. With for sentiment, formality, etc. So with appropriate prior, given the probability, given observation X, the base VAE includes a conditional probability encoder to infer the latents Z. Okay. Theta G and theta E denote the parameter of the generator and encoder respectively. The VAE is then optimized to minimize the reconstruction error of observed real sentences and at the same time regularize the encoder to be close to the prior. So you use the KL divergence here. And this is the conditional distribution defined by a discriminator D for each structured variable in C. So you have different structured variables, and the conditional distribution for each of them will be different with respect to a discriminator. So here for notation simplicity, we assume only one structured variable and thus one discriminator, but for each structured variable you have one different discriminator. The distribution over Z, C factors into QE and QD as we are learning disentangled representations. Note that here the discriminator D and code C are not learned with the VAE laws, but instead optimized with the objectives described shortly. Besides the reconstruction loss which drives the generator to produce realistic sentences, the discriminator provides extra learning signals which enforce the generator to produce coherent attribute that matches the structured code in C. However, as it is impossible to propagate gradients from the discriminator through the discrete samples, we resort to a deterministic continuous approximation. The approximation replaces the sampled token at each step with a probability vector which is differentiable with respect to the generator parameter. The probability vector is used as input. So instead of just giving one token, they are giving the probability distribution of all different tokens. The probability vector is used as the output at the current step and the input to the next step along the sequence of decision making. The resulting soft generated sentence denoted as this is fed into the discriminator to measure the fitness to target attribute, leading to the following loss for improving G. So this is the loss function for the discriminator, and I guess this was quite clear here why we are using the probability vector. It is because discrete tokens then again cause problems, because you have to use this deterministic continuous approximation. You cannot use discrete stuff, because then you would have problem with propagating gradients through them. So they use this approximation where instead of having just a token, they have a probability distribution. Then this comes out to be the loss function for the generator. The temperature tau is set to zero as training proceeds, so it is reduced, yielding increasingly peak distribution that finally emulate discrete case. The simple deterministic approximation effectively leads to reduced variance and fast convergence during training, which enables efficient learning of the conditional generator. The diversity of generation results is guaranteed, since we use the approximation only for attribute modeling, and the base sentence generation is learned through variational autoencoders. So the diversity of general results is guaranteed. Generation results is guaranteed since we use approximation only for attribute modeling, and the base sentence generation is learned through variational autoencoders. So the approximation is not used in this part. With the objective in equation 6, so the loss function for the generator. Each structured attribute of the generated sentences is controlled through the corresponding code in C and is independent with other variables in the latent representation. Alright, so however, it is still possible that other attributes are not explicitly modeled may also entangle with the code in C, and thus varying a dimension of C can yield unexpected variation of these attributes we are not interested in. To address this, we introduce an independency constraint which separates those attributes with C by enforcing them to be fully captured by the unstructured part Z. So suppose there are 10 attributes, only 3 of them need to be manipulated, then the rest 7 need to be forced to be a part of Z, which is not structured. Therefore, besides the attributes explicitly encoded in C, we also train the generator so that the other non-explicit attributes can be recognized correctly from the generated samples and match the unstructured code Z. So instead of building a new discriminator, we reuse the variational encoder E, which serves precisely to infer the latent Z in the base variational autoencoder. The loss is in the same form as with equation 6, except replacing the discriminator conditional QD with encoder conditional Q. So basically you have this loss function now, but instead of since this is for the wait a second, did I misread something? Instead of building a new discriminator, we reuse the variational encoder E, which serves precisely to infer latent Z. The loss is in the form. Okay, so this is the loss function to enforce Z to have the non-used attributes. So they use this loss function. Note, as a discriminator in equation 6, the encoder now performs inference over generated samples from the prior as compared to opposed to observed samples as in the variational autoencoders. So now you have to minimize all of these losses. The variational autoencoder loss, a loss where you minimize the this part minimizes the fact that the unstructured vector Z should have the non-important attributes, so the attributes which are not going to be changed, and this should have the attributes which are going to be changed. So this minimizes their loss. Alright, so lambda C and lambda Z are balancing parameters. The variational encoder is trained by minimizing the loss, by minimizing this. Alright. So discriminator learning. The discriminator D is trained to accurately infer the sentence attribute and evaluate the error of recovering the desired feature as specified in the latent code. For instance, for categorical attribute, the discriminator can be formulated as a sentence classifier, while for continuous target, a probability regressor can be used. Alright. So the discriminator is learned in a different way compared to the autoencoder. Since the target attributes can be discrete, which are not supported in the VAE framework. Moreover, in contrast,
to the unstructured code z, which is learned in an unsupervised manner. The structured variable c uses labeled examples to entail designated semantics. So we derive an efficient semi-supervised learning method for the discriminator. So formally, let theta d denote the parameters of the discriminator to learn a specified meaning. They use a set of examples to train the discriminator to be able to identify a particular example x has an attribute c. Beside the conditional generator, c is also capable of synthesizing noisy sentence pair attributes, which can be used to augment the training data. So instead of just having these good examples, they also give noisy examples to alleviate the issue of noisy data and ensure robustness of model optimization. They incorporate a minimum entropy regularization term. So this is not something which I'm very familiar with, but this is also something which they incorporate to deal with noisy data, because the model should be able to handle noisy data as well. Just a second. This is empirical Shannon interval of distribution evaluated on sentences, and it has the balancing parameter. Intuitively, the minimum entropy regularization encourages the model to have high confidence in predicting labels. Okay. The joint training mechanism now is you have this LU times lambda U, a balancing parameter, and LS is this earlier loss. LS is this loss. So you need to predict the correct label and also have deal with noisy data. All of these are to be minimized for the discriminator loss. Now, what's really happening? So you have a large corpus and you have some attribute pairs. You have these parameters. You initialize the autoencoder. Then you train the discriminator by equation 11. Equation 11 is this. By minimizing this. Then you train the generator by these equations and do this till it converges, and then the output is a sentence generator G conditioned on the disentangled representation Z and C. So now you only require this generator G, and this is the figure for this case. Where was this figure referenced to? Let's have a look at it. The left one shows the VAE and wake procedure corresponding to equation 4. So which was equation 4? The equation 4 was a KL divergence equation. So you have vector Z and C as the unstructured vector and the attribute controlling vector. You generate X, and then you have then you use these conditional probabilities and measure the distribution between them, I guess. Yeah. You measure the difference between them. And for the write the sleep procedure, black arrows denote inference and generation, red optimizing the discriminator and the generator respectively. So you first optimize the discriminator, then you optimize the generator, and so on. Summarization discussion. We have derived a model and its learning procedure. The generator is first initialized by training the base VAE on a large corpus of unlabeled sentences. Though the objective of minimizing equation 4 with the latent code C at this time sampled from the prior distribution PC, the full model is then trained by alternating the optimization of the generator and the discriminator as summarized in algorithm 1. Our model can be viewed as combining the VAE framework with extended VXLEAP and so on. Samples are produced by the generator as users target for maximum likelihood of the discriminator. This resembles the sleep phase of wake-sleep. Equation 6 to 7 further leverage the generator sample to improve the generator. We can see the above together as extended sleep procedure based on dream samples obtained by ancestral sampling from the generative network. On the other hand, equation 4 samples C from discriminator distribution on observation X to form target for training the generator, which corresponds to the wake phase. So the effective combination enables discrete latent code, holistic discriminator matrix, and efficient mutual bootstrapping. So this is basically how they are going to, why are they saying that this resembles the wake sleep algorithm. So training of the discriminator needs supervised data to impose designated semantics. so it should be able to recognize the different attributes, that it should know what the correct attributes are. So the simulators for different attributes can be trained independently on separate label sets. That is, the model does not require a sentence to be annotated with all attributes, but instead only the attributes which are being tested. Moreover, all the label data are used only for learning instead of direct sentence generation. We are allowed to extend the data scope beyond labeled sentences, for example, labeled word or phrases. As shown in the experiments, our method is able to effectively lift the word-level knowledge to sentence level and generate convincing sentences. Finally, the augmented unsupervised training in the sleep phase is visual, little supervision is sufficient for learning structured representations. Okay. So the experiments. They use a sentence corpus, the IMDb sentence corpus, which has 350,000 movie reviews. They also have sentiment, so they have positive and negative sentiment. For that, they use the Stanford Sentiment Tree Bank 2, which has movie reviews. Okay, they use this to study the size of labeled data required. Okay, we also investigate the effectiveness in terms of word level. So they use Lexicon, which has sentiment label. Okay, then they use IMDb, which also has positive and negative reviews. So this is for the sentiment part totally. For the tense, they use there is no good corpus, they say. So they compile from time bank dataset and obtain a lexicon of 5 to 50 words with phrases labeled past, present, or future. The lexicon was mainly consisted of verbs and different tenses, was, will be. Okay. So this makes sense. Note that our method requires only separate label corpora for each attribute, so they do not need one for combined sentiment and tense. Parameter setting. The generator encoder are set on single layer LSTM RNNs with hidden dimension of 300 and max sample length of 15. Discriminators are set as convolutional nets. Detailed configuration are in the subnet. Okay. To avoid vanishingly small KL term in the VAE module, we use a KL term weighted linearly. They set these balancing parameters. Okay. So let's have a look at the results. So on each of the data sets, they are getting quite good improvements. So we'll see, this is a 0.03, this is a 0.03 again, this is a 0.04 approximately. So accuracy, we qualitatively measure sentence attribute control by evaluating the accuracy of generating designated sentiment and the effect of using samples for training classifiers. We compare with semi-supervised VA, one of the few existing deep models capable of conditional text generation. SVA learns to reconstruct observed sentences given attribute code, and no discriminators are used. Okay. So we use state-of-the-art sentiment classifiers which achieve 90% accuracy on SST tested to automatically evaluate the sentiment generation accuracy. Specifically, we generate sentences with given sentiment code C and use the pre-trained sentiment classifier to assign sentiment label to a generated sentence. The accuracy is calculated as a percentage of the predictions that match the sentiment code C. So this is these are the results. These are the statistical differences. So theirs is almost everywhere outperforming. It's outperforming everywhere, to be honest. More importantly, given only word level annotation lexicon, our model successfully transfers the knowledge to sentence level. Compared to our method that drives learning by differently assessing generated sentences, SVA attempts to capture sentiment semantics only by reconstructing labeled words, which is less efficient and gives inferior performance. Okay, so the paper is almost over. So we next use the generated samples to augment the sentiment datasets and train sentiment classifier. While not aiming to build best performance classifier on these datasets, the classification accuracy serves as an auxiliary measure of the sentence generation quality. That is, higher quality sentences with more accurate sentiment attribute can predictably help yield strong sentiment classifiers. So standard is a CONNET trained on standard original datasets with the same network. HREG additionally imposes a minimum entropy regularization. RS incorporates the minimum entropy regularization, the sentiment attribute code C. SVA uses. So these are describing different models which they've compared against. Disentangled representation. We study the interpretability of generation and explicitly independency constraint for disentangled control in table 2. So where is table 2? Here. Okay. In the left column, you have constraint. In the other one, you don't. Each pair of sentences conditioned on different sentiment quotes are highly relevant in terms of subject tone wording, which are not explicitly modeled in the structured code C, while instead implicitly encoded in the unstructured code Z. Varying the sentiment code precisely changes the sentiment of the sentences. In contrast, the results in the right column, where the dependency constraint is unactivated, show that varying the sentiment code not only changes the polarity of samples, but can also change other aspects unexpected to control, making the generation results less interpretable and predictable. We demonstrate the power of learned disentangled representation by varying one attribute variable at a time. We see that each attribute variable in our model successfully controls its corresponding attribute and is disentangled with other attribute code. The right column of the table shows meaningful variation. Okay, let's just have a look at this. So samples of the model. Each sample are generated with sentiment code set to negative positive respectively. Okay. The film is strictly routine, the acting is bad. The film is full of imagination, the movie is so much fun. This is with independency constraint and this is without independency constraint. So here, independency constraint is basically you try to fix attributes into Z, the unstructured code Z. Okay, so you can see differences. For sentences, I thought the movie was too bland. I guess the movie is too bland. I guess the movie will have been too bland. And without the dependency constraint, each triple of sentence is generated by varying the tense code while fixing the sentiment code in Z. And then you vary the unstructured code Z, you give it negative pass or positive pass and so on. So these are the results. And then they also have some failure cases where the varying sentiment code with other codes fixed and it did not work well. Okay, right. So discussion, we have proposed a deep generative model that learns interpretable latent distribution, generates sentences with specified attributes. We obtain meaningful generation with restricted sentence length and improve accuracy. In the future, we would like to improve the modeling and training as above and extend to generate longer sentences and control more attributes. Our approach combines VAEs with attribute discriminators and imposes explicitly independency constraints on attribute control, enabling disentangled latent code. Semi-supervised learning with the joint VAE wake sleep framework is effective with little or incomplete supervision. Who at all 2017 developed a unified view of a diverse set of deep generative paradigms, including GANs, VAEs, and wake sleep algorithms. Our model can be alternatively motivated under the view as enhancing VAEs with the extended sleep phase by leveraging generated samples. Interpretability of the latent representations not only allows dynamic control of generated attributes, but also provides an interface that connects the end-to-end model. For instance, we can encode structured information. Alright, I plugged the disentangled generation model into Dialog. Right. So though we have focused on generation capacity of our model, the proposed collaborative semi-supervised learning framework also helps improve the discriminators by generating labeled samples for data augmentation. Most generally, for any discriminative task, we can build a conditional generative model to synthesize additional labeled data. The accurate attribute generation of our approach can offer larger performance gain compared to previous generative methods. So they have the implementation on GitHub. In this repository, so I guess this is it because I do not see anything more. But this was quite a good read, especially I found this part pretty interesting on how they had different discriminators to control the different attributes and how they tried to enforce the unused attributes to remain in Z. So thank you guys for watching. As always, if you have any comments or anything which you would like to ask or share or like to correct in the video, then please comment down below if I made some mistakes. And this was the first time reading this paper, but I'll probably be reading more such papers in the future. So thank you guys for joining in. See, hope you see you guys the next time.